Stock Traders, and welcome back to Stock Traders Talk Radio on this fabulous Wednesday, May 30th. I'm your host, Stock Sumo, and you know what time it is, folks. I don't need to remind you. It's time to top off your cup of coffee with Stock Traders Talk Radio as we begin to look through the OTC markets. Open up your charts, turn on those scanners, and fire up your trading accounts. Joining us on this morning's program, we have Haas. Good morning, Haas.
Good morning, Stock Sumo. You know, I'm tired every single morning when we start this show, but after your intro, I just wake up. So I appreciate your enthusiasm for the morning show every single morning, buddy.
Well, I've been getting up a little bit earlier and trying to get that coffee in me so I can get all ready and get amped up, get everything fired up, and get ready to roll so we can make it fun for the audience and all the listeners out there. We got the chat room going, so that's exciting. We got more interaction. We got the video stream. We got the call-in number. It really doesn't get any better for the audience. We're here for you guys, so please take full use of that stuff. Get in the chat room. Tell us what you want us to talk about. Share your comments. Feel free to call us up. The call-in number is 855-STT-LIVE, or you can also call us in at 347-215-7181. And also, on this morning's program, we have Sifakia.
Aloha, Sumo. Haas, what's up, boys?
Yo, buddy.
Just ready to rock, baby. How's the weather over there in Hawaii at 3 a.m.? Or whatever time it is out there.
It's slow. Do your thing, man. I'm a technical guy here. Why go to me so much so quick, huh?
Because we always want to hear from you. Well, I'll let Haas get into the OTC stuff because I got a few big boards that I want to cover. And when we're ready to talk about those, maybe you could chime in on some of your thoughts and give me some of your feedback on some of the plays that I want to discuss. So, Haas, why don't you take it away for some OTC stuff?
All right. I'll do my best not to babble too much this morning about my little mini spotlight, but it might turn out to be pretty difficult because I really like this company. And Kot, me and Siffy were talking about this one the other night and said this sucker was getting loaded around the 2 cent area. Anyways, moving over to my screen here, we have the mini morning spotlight JNS Holdings Corporation, looking quite attractive as of late, both fundamentally and technically. So we'll take a look at the chart a little later after I'm done babbling here. We're going to start off at their actual website for JNS Holdings Corporation, and as the name of the company states, it is a holding company, so they have a couple of different key subsidiaries. So what we'll do here is we'll go down on this website here and look at this mergers and acquisitions, click on that guy, and it shows they have two little subsidiaries, one pretty important one for the company, and the second one is a little less significant at the current time, so we won't spend any time on that, to tell you the truth. But their main subsidiary that's bringing in most of their revenues right now and their sales is this JNS Power and Control Systems Incorporated. So what we're going to do is go, you can just click on that and it actually goes to the JNS website, but I already clicked on it, so we'll just move over that screen for me. So JNS Power and Control Systems Incorporated, main subsidiary of JNS Holdings Corporation. Tons of services offered. One of the things that they were doing for the past several years is this temperature control system installation, which was bringing in most of their revenues. But now, as of within the past couple of years, they've been bringing in a lot of contracts for some of their expansion services. We have fire alarm and life safety system installation, power distribution, design build, commercial construction, data and communication cabling, lighting control, solar power system installation, electric vehicle charging stations, wind turbine power installation. So as you can see by these last three services that they offer here, they're expanding quite a bit into the alternative energy markets. And they've been putting out some press related to installation of these electric vehicle charging stations throughout Illinois recently. So some pretty cool stuff going on, and we're not talking about, you know, small amounts of money or some, you know, no-name, you know, buildings and companies that these guys are providing services for. As you can say here, Trump Chicago, you know, we're talking about Illinois here. They've done some of these projects in some of the most well-known buildings that everyone knows, you know, the Trump Tower. Let's look at some of these highlighted projects that they've done. Huge tower in downtown Chicago here. The North 155 North Wacker Building. This thing is not small by any means. Let's see here. We got 1.38 million square foot Class A office. I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but big stuff. The next one over here, we have the Trump International Hotel and Tower. And they've also done tons of other well-known buildings. And, you know, on the iHub on iBox, you can look in this completed projects thing right here. It shows how many projects and, you know, they've been installing these electric car charging stations and, you know, a bunch of Walgreens and different types of well-known business operations like that. You know, wind turbines, this is a completed project, high rises, ComEd substations. So in other words, they're bringing in a lot of business, okay? Well-known buildings and their business is growing. So let's actually go take at how much that business is growing. This is the most recent quarterly statement for JNS Power and Control Systems. All right, so they just put this out in May 9th, I believe. So for the first 3 months of 2012, we're looking at income of around $550,000. So on a forward-looking basis, you know, that's $2 to $2.5 million in revenues right now per year. But even more significantly than that is the actual net operating profits on that. You know, you get from $550,000, you got a gross profit of about $350,000. And you have a net profit. If you scroll all the way down, net income, net profit, pretty close. You got net ordinary income, just under $180,000, and net income of $180,000 on that $550,000 in revenues. So definitely operating on a pretty good margin there as far as what sort of services they are offering. And that is up significantly. We'll go check out how, just how much that is up over the previous years here. But I just did wanted to look at one more thing on this, and that is the actual current share structure. Actually, one more thing, just the asset to liability ratio. We have about $790,000 in assets versus current liabilities, total liabilities about $508,000. So asset to liability ratio, you always want to see that over one. So that's really good as well, especially for a company at this stage. But the actual share structure, and it's actually stated on their website pretty specifically as of May 24th, 2012. So this is very, very current. 122 million authorized shares, 108 million outstanding shares, and about 51 million shares in the public float. So moving over to iHub here, we can tease out some pretty important information on, you know, what else is going on with this company. Obviously, we mentioned the quarterly financial results for 2012. Very, very significant. And there are a couple things I want to point out about this. If it'll load quicker, load, please. Please load. That's really annoying. Anyways, let's try this again. There we go. Sometimes you just got to click twice, I guess. Anyways, we noted the 550,000 revenues. 68% increase, greater than the same quarter from 2011 for the first 3 months. So revenues increasing very, very significantly. We mentioned that the gross were 65% of those revenues, and net profits is 33% of those revenues or income, compared 180,000 compared to 107,000 the previous year. So net profits, net operating margins increasing significantly. But there are a couple other things that I wanted to point out in here, and I believe it was stated by the CEO. Yeah, they're choosing to strengthen their bottom line here. Our first quarter financial improvement in sales and revenue is a great start into the new year, said Gene Howe, president and CEO. Our team worked very hard to increase sales and improve profitability, which has resulted in a stronger return and additional cash flow. With this additional cash flow, we chose to strengthen our bottom line and use this additional revenue to pay down our line of credit by 57%, or $250,000 from 1 year ago, whereby significantly increasing our current ratio and decreasing our debt to equity ratio. So they're paying down debts. Very, very significant here. We noted the asset to liability ratio was very attractive. I'm pleased we were able to reduce our debt, buy back a vast number of shares of our common stock, and still show a profit in 2011. All right, so they're taking their cash flow, paying down debt significantly, and buying back shares. All right, as a shareholder or potential shareholder, you absolutely want to hear all of those things. I feel these decisions will translate very well for JNS and our shareholders in 2012. And I'm going to actually go to another press release if I can. Let's see here. Let's see if I can find it. I'll babble until I find it. No, I'm just joking. Maybe it was in the fiscal year 2011 results. I honestly can't even remember what press release it was in. But anyways, let's see here. Well, I'm not going to spend too much time on it. The key thing with paying down that debt is they were able to extend their line of credit significantly, or apply for a larger line of credit, which is going to allow them to bring in more significant projects in the near future throughout 2012. So, you know, very positive asset to liability ratio, revenues increasing dramatically in 2011 compared to previous years, and even in the first quarter of 2012 as compared to previous years and quarters. And they're buying back shares on the open market. And I want to take a quick look at the iBox, is where I believe it was, and show just, you know, we see recent changes in float here from April 4th, 2011 to April 9th, 2012. As you can see, we've gone from a float of about 60 million shares down to about 50 million shares. 51 here is what was noted in the most recent quarterly. So very significant there. They bought about, you know, 10 million shares out of the float. We mentioned that buyback, and, you know, so very significant buyback there from insiders in the company. They're using their cash flow to buy back shares and reduce debt. Very, very, very positive sign for shareholders and future shareholders. And with that net profit that we mentioned, which was about $108,000, we're looking at a price-to-earnings ratio of, I believe, like sub-5, if I'm calculating in my head correctly, which is very, very significant. You know, you got a small, super high growth stage company at a PE of sub-5, net profitable, paying down debts in big ways, buying back shares. That's undervaluation to the max, and you're not going to find that too often in the over-the-counter pinky stinky world. One thing that's potentially not so positive is if we go over to Pink Sheets here, you see their limited information right now. We'd like to see them, you know, get over-the-counter pink current. And I wouldn't doubt if these guys shoot for an uplisting in the very, very near future. But a great company. And we caught this thing getting loaded as we move over to DD Amanda here at the 2 cent area. I believe I was talking with Scythian Cop the other night about this one. We were talking about this. We were going to spotlight it one of the other nights or something. But as you can see here, pretty low volume throughout the beginning of the year for the most part, as it hung around this 2 cent area for what seemed like forever. And then all of a sudden, you know, here on May 9th-ish, after they put out that quarterly financial that we just went over with those amazing numbers, this thing starts to get loaded a little bit, right? You know, had a little bit of a bump on some increasing volume, consolidated a little bit, but, you know, still holding that two cent support area. You can tell people are still interested, just loading the boat here. And then just within the last couple of days, even more significantly increasing volume, a few $30,000 days over the last few trading days as the share price has gone from about 2 cents to 2.8 cents. And people are taking notes a little bit. Nice few green candles here. Let's talk a little bit more about this change in money here. Why don't we take a look at the chart? I don't know who's got it for me, but whoever's got the chart for me for JNSH, please take it away.
Sure, I got the chart, no problem. Okay, we'll look at the six-month chart here first, and then we'll take it back a couple of years. You can see going back here in February, you had these moving averages, which were like all bunched in around each other here. And once this 20-day, that's the one we like to watch the most, I would think, because it's just the most recent. So the 20-day, we're watching this one here. And then all of a sudden, as it comes up here and breaks through both the 50-day and the 100-day, notice it bounced off of the 200-day. It dipped below there just for a second, but it came back above it. And then this is when the stock really started to make its move up once the 20-day came through and crossed through the 50 and 100-day moving averages. And boom, she just went to the top side all the way from as low as 0.095 back here in January and up to 0.026. And then she's been trading sideways since, but notice she's been bouncing off of the 100-day moving average very well, level of support there, and that's a very good sign because she's staying above that. Let's go down here and look at the RSI. She just passed through the 50 overlay and getting up into the power zone. Once it gets to the 70 to 90 range, that'll be considered the power zone. And as you've seen in the past here, when the stock gets in the power zone, it tends to have a nice price appreciation. So if the RSI can keep moving up in the power zone, and you know, that'll be a very good sign. We got the PPO that just crossed over, and that's kissing the 50 overlay. So I'd like to see it keep going, trucking up north. The blue bars in the histogram just flipped to the top side. Those are positive. I'd like to see those continue to get larger, and the slow stow is pointing north and it's breaking through that 50 overlay. This 50 overlay is a very important factor, and so far I'm digging all the technicals on the chart because in every scenario it's either above it or trying to get above it. So all in all, this chart's really nice, but let's go back a couple years here and see where this thing has been in the past, because we're at a point right now where it's going blue sky, because the previous high that this stock had was back in 2010, around August, September. It was as high as 0.029. And for whatever reason, it couldn't get above that. It came down, had some bounces in between here and then. But now we're back to that 0.029 level. So if she breaks above that, there's no telling where she can go. All right, Haas, back to you, bud.
Good stuff, man. Yeah, I mean, this company is starting to amaze me a little bit. You know, they're sitting at a market cap of about, you know, 3 to 3.5 million right now, bringing in 2 to 2.5 million in revenues on a forward-looking basis if we assume no growth. But there's surely going to be a lot of growth throughout 2012. And that's even after they've, you know, they've been paying down debts significantly and buying back shares on the open market. They're still bringing in, you know, net profit on a forward-looking basis of dang near $750,000 a year. And, you know, now their line of credit is getting extended because they've paid down their debt to basically nil. So they're going to be able to bring in some bigger projects in 2012, and they're expanding into the green energy sector. With some of their temperature control systems, their wind electrical power control systems, the electric vehicle charging stations, and you're sitting at a float of 50 million shares, and this thing was getting loaded around 2 cents. I mean, that's just a no-brainer. That's awesome stuff right there. But before I babble on too long about JNSH, I'm going to hand it over to you guys. to do some big board stuff. I know you got some options plays to talk about. Why don't I hand it over to Siffy first? Let him do his thing, and you guys can play off each other a little bit with that. Roll, Sif. Tell me something good.
We got to get him reading our little private room sometimes, huh, Sumo?
Yeah, what are you going to do?
I'm going to go ahead and pass that off to Sumo because I'm having technical difficulty with my sound.
I'm actually not getting the feedback I was.
You're not getting the feedback?
No, it sounds good now, but why don't you talk about what Ford options have been doing? I know Cop and I kind of went a little bit toe-to-toe together last night. He didn't understand where I was coming from because, you know, even though the stock only has made a dollar or something move off of its bottom, he doesn't understand how the, you know, the options you can make 100%. So why don't you break it down, because I know you're a lot better at explaining these because you understand them fundamentally a lot more than me because you've been trading them so much, and I've been learning a lot being alongside you. So go with it, bud.
All right. Well, I thought you made a good case, man. And, you know, Cop loves big boards. He just wanted to mess with you. But the one thing you didn't tell him, which I kept on hoping you were going to say, was, here, let's get rid of all these lines. This is what we drew the other day, guys, when we were drawing our little lines. But let's get rid of all these little lines here. And the reason why we entered Ford was the same reason we entered Ford the last time it hit the 200 MA, is you got to respect that 200-day moving average. You can see it running right there. You can see when you broke out. Let's take this back even farther. Let's go back 10 years, all right? And let's see what happened here. As you can see, this, you know what? Let's stick with 10 years. You can see right here back in 04, it hit that 200 MA. And let's go ahead and draw some lines here. Get my trend line going. Okay. And you could either drop that, you know, right on the, you know, how we always like to stack on the last candle. So let's go ahead and do that. And you can see that was your downtrend and it's running. And right here, this is the break of your downtrend. And it not only was the break of a downtrend that was over 5 years in the making, it's breaking out of that 200 MA. And you got to love the way charts always end up coming back to the lines. Because, I mean, really, that's all these moving averages are. I mean, they're the moving average of the price per share over a period of time, but it's just like drawing a straight line. They're just a little more squiggly. So over, you know, eventually they all come together, and you can see when this came together, it coincided with it breaking out of that 200 MA, okay? Breakout. Now let's draw some more lines. So this is the bottom of the channel, and we had a nice little run. And you can stack it on this first one right here. And you can see basically what happened there. It found its support, but I'm going to go ahead and stack it on this second one. And that's going to coincide with the squiggly 50-day moving average. But anyways, you can see what's going on here. And another thing I want to do is go ahead and draw another line right here, because that's going to give you your topside projection of a longer-term channel. And let's draw one over here on the bottom just for the fun of it, if I can get it to work. Yep, there we go. And we'll drop that right there. And that's going to give us a downside. And you could even drop one on here, the very, very bottom, and that even give you a bigger downside channel. Because, you know, over a period of time, I mean, if you're a longer-term investor, I'm talking 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years. You know, I'm only 35. I don't plan on retiring until I'm, you know, over 55, 60, maybe 65. So, you know, sometimes you got to have the long-term perspective. So what's this chart going to do? And drawing these lines here and extending them in 15, 20 years, you might be reconnecting with this line right here if Ford breaks. But let me get back to my point here. You had the breakout of the 200 MA. You had one hell of a run. We got the line coming up here. You can see when it broke this trend, it fell like a rock. And boom, where did it find its support? 200 MA. And then we came up and we were trading in this tight little channel, and that channel, you could take it off of this swing low here. You could stack it basically anywhere on these lines, and you can pretty much see how that played out. The resistance becomes a support. The support now becomes a resistance. And that 200 MA setting there, we came down, we clipped it again. Now that we've seen all this BS, we're going to come into that weekly 3-year. And boom, there she is. We were buying the 200 MA. So when we did this, guys, what we did is we went with an August. We went with the $11 call. All right. You can see that right here. It's got 11,739 open interest. The last trade was 56. We entered that at 35. I actually exited yesterday for 55. But you can see here, let's pull this out. Let's look at it daily. And you can see what this thing has done. This is our entry right down here. And you can see it's gone straight up. And, you know, basically what you're looking at on this, guys, is let's go back to it real quick. When we entered at 35 cents, basically it was trading around 10 bucks. So it's just been moving up. And I want to pull back now. It looks like Ford's down 1%. So that's what the way we put our money on the line. So let's look at it this way. If you would have wanted to buy 1,000 shares of Ford at 10 bucks, you just invested $10,000. Yesterday you sold it. Let's say you got the top. Let's say you got that 1086. So you made yourself 860 bucks, which is a great trade. All right. What is it? 8.6, almost 9% you made. So awesome trade. But I didn't want to put 10G down on Ford because what if I was wrong and it went to $9? I got to take my loss with the stop. Of course, stops are always in place. But the way I played it was I went ahead and picked up for a $350 investment. I controlled 1,000 shares of Ford. Yeah, you sell it at 55. You made yourself a whole 200 bucks. But hey, I'd rather make 200 bucks off of 350 than 800 off 10G. But that's just me. So that's the way we played Ford. And the reason why we played it was, like we said, a technical move off of the weekly chart, and you can see it right here, plain as day. You gotta respect that 200 MA, and respect we did, and she's paying us today, hopefully, or not today, she paid us yesterday, and hopefully today we get a discount, and I'm keeping her on the radar. Ford August, $11 call. Back to you, Haas, Sumo, who wants it?
Sumo does.
No, actually, I got a couple of NASDAQ plays that I want Siffy to analyze because I'm looking at them as a possible opportunity. Maybe there could be some good options trades out of them. I posted them in the room. AMBT, ticker symbol X, DAKT, and TiVo. Siffy, take it away.
Hit me with the first one again.
That's TiVo, T-I-V-O.
TiVo. All right. Looks like our market is open. And there's our discount. It's down to 50 by 54, so not much of a discount. It's not huge. TiVo, you can look at the daily 1 year here. It looks pretty solid. Looks like we got a few supports going on right here. Got 1, 2, 3. Looks like they bought it. Looks like it's trying to head higher. You've got yourself a gap right here. You see this gap right here, guys? Looks like they went ahead and filled her finally. So I'd eye that 20-day moving average. Let's look to the options on TiVo. How come it's not working?
Looks good on, to me, TiVo. Bud. Oh, showed it.
Supposed to be linked up. TiVo's not going. Well, I don't know why it's not working. We'll pull it up automatically here. It's supposed to be linked for me. Sorry about that, guys. All right, so you know how I am, Sumo. Even though I played the Ford and it's a low multiple, I usually go for higher multiple stocks. So you can look all the way out to August. You can see there's no volume here. November, no volume. July, no volume. June, nothing. You got 38 trades on the $9 put. So who knows what that is. But yeah, TiVo's not really an option play. You know, so you're long the shares and you're using the options to hedge yourself either by selling calls or buying puts. So Don't really like TiVo much as for options, but the trade might be good. Looks like it found support. What's your next one, Sumo?
Okay, cool. Thanks. That's U.S. Steel. I know you like this one as far as a chart standpoint. That's ticker symbol X.
All right. Looks like we've looked at this one a few times. Let's erase these lines here. And you can see U.S. Steel. We played this thing. Sumo actually caught it when it ran up to this 200 MA right here, this run. Sumo caught it. It was a double. It broke through that 200 MA, but then it was having a hard time. It actually might have been one of these runs in here. Looking back on this, this is a daily. But basically what we said was it was getting tighter and tighter and tighter along here. And we said, keep watch out. If it can't get up, she's going to fall. And fall she did. And you can see she's came way down now. So we can go ahead and say that as of now, it looks like we've got ourselves a little bit of a bottom. But you've got yourself some resistance going on here, your old support. We'll stack that right in there. So it looks like, you know, based just on this, where it found support back in last year, looks like now it's a resistance. Keep your eye on that 20 MA. It's up around 24. As for the options, let's go take a look at it, see what the street thinks they're taking her. Why is this thing not linking for me? That's weird. Oh, well, do it manually. You can see there's not a lot of action on this either. You got 20 on the 25 call. You've got 15 on the 23. Let's look at a little bit in July. Again, you got 20 contracts traded on the 20. Let's look October, nothing. Let's see what they're doing this weekly. The weekly, it looks like you got 100. So far, the most active is the 22 put. It's got 143 contracts traded on it. It's at 59 by 63. So somebody's basically, you know, looks like they're saying there that it's going to stay under that 22. So because you want to be selling that out of the money thinking it's going to be going. I mean, you could be selling that 22 put and taking that premium, but you would need this thing to take off and start rallying and get above that 22. So it's always hard to say what they're actually doing with that. If you got 40 contracts traded on the 21 call, it's trading at 97 by a buck 02. Looks like your largest open interest on the call is at 23 strike. So yeah, it is beaten up. Let's keep it on the radar. But yeah, I don't know. It's another one that doesn't look like it's the greatest option trades right now. But that's what I said last time when it was a two bagger. But not high liquidity. Let's look at some high liquidity here, shall we? Let's look at Apple. Here's the Apple chart. Now let's go to the options and let's see what the volume's on this thing. Boom. That's what I'm talking about. You got 1,500, 1,200 contracts traded already. Let's take a look at this one here. Let's throw this to, Man, I suck today. Market death, give it to me. All right, let's link this. And we can check it out here. So, man, that can't get a break. You know what? What's going on in that OTC market, guys? Hit us up, Haas. I know you got something better than this for the listeners.
Unfortunately, I really don't. It's a kind of a boring morning so far, but we can go over some stuff anyways. Obviously looking at Viper this morning, took a huge, huge dip on massive volume yesterday. I think there were, it was like $900,000 in trading volume on Viper. It was obviously very, very healthy. It was pretty fat up there at that 005 area, and it probably needed the pullback. But it's looking okay so far this morning. Just under 2 million shares in volume, up 14.7% last trade at 0039. Current spread is 0035 by 0039, so much quieter this morning. But they did put out another little fluffy press release, and hearing rumors that there's going to be another push. But it's looking okay so far this morning, forming some nice bid support. Level 2 on the ask, that actually looks pretty thin. back up to 005s. One market maker I do want to keep an eye on is that VNDM sitting there on 0045 if it does test him and see how thick he is. But other than that, level two is looking pretty good to start off the day. Looks like RTGV is boring this morning. It had a little push towards the end of the day back into the 004s, but we'll just skip over it because it's not looking too good right now. Let's see. IDVC was pretty hot yesterday. 2 million shares in volume so far today. Current spread 0035 by 0036. Last trade 0035 plus 6.1%. What did Cop say about that one yesterday? He said to not touch it at this point. I think that's what he said. I don't remember. Anyways, AGRT, super hot one yesterday. Looks like they also put out some press this morning, but taking a little dip early on today. Opened up at 48 cents after her 50.2 cent close yesterday, dipped down to 40 cents, and now it's trumping back upwards a little bit. Last trade at 48, minus 4.4%, but already over a million volume, so really, really active again. Definitely keeping an eye on that one for some potential trading opportunities. Sumo, you got anything on your level two screen, man? Anything interesting? What can I pull up? Give me something. Give me something good.
What do we got here? AUCI making a move out of the gate, hitting the scanner. Aussie Auctions International, it's up 52% today on over 4 million shares. ELEV, Elevate, it's up 163% on 158,000 shares. Last trade at 50 cents. So those two are big movers here this morning out of the gate. CPOW, CPOW, looks like it's coming off a bottom on light volume, 433,000 shares traded. All right, back to you, Haas.
Yeah, I was just taking a look at this Aussie. I'm actually going to go check out that news. We did the mini spotlight on it the other week, and I wonder if it's related to their Amaro International merger / acquisition. I apologize. Level 2 and iHub is really, 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 really slow for me today for whatever reason, but pleased to announce the conclusion of a merger with Amaro International. Go figure. Called it. Now this one is actually a pretty thin share. This is the beginning of a new and exciting future for this new company. Auctions International Incorporated will remain as the company's main identity for the foreseeable future. This will be the case at least until Aussie becomes fully reporting, at which time would be the logical point to rethink the identity for the future. Is it just me or did that read kind of weird? Never mind. We'll go back to the level two screen because I don't want to talk about that all day. But getting a few hits, current spread 0024 by 0027. Up 41.2%, as Sumo mentioned. Now 58.8% last trade, 0027, 5.7 million in volume. So getting some pretty good action. And as you can see on the level two screen, it's actually pretty thin both ways. So it can go up and down quick. I can't remember what we did our little mini spotlight at, but it was probably around current prices, around the 003 area. I think it actually dipped down over the next couple of days, but this Amaro International merger completion is actually probably the biggest news this company can put out at this point. So we'll see what it does the rest of the day. The spread's pretty large right now, which I don't necessarily like to see, but getting a few taps on the ask. We'll see how that plays out throughout the rest of the week here. Ooh, Viper dipping back down into the red, actually, which is quite surprising, but getting a little bit of action, almost 3.5 million in volume now. AGRT, we mentioned it took that little dip early on. I can't remember if it finished, what was it, like 100 and some percent up yesterday? Don't even remember anymore. But last traded 53.6 cents, now up 6.8%. Opportunities to add as low as 40 cents today. Looks like a classic little dip and rip going on here. Still getting a nice little push. Some pretty thick bid support there on 53 cents, actually, which is nice to see. 1.3 million in volume now. Let's see what we can find here. Let's go look at some actives. man. Annoying. Well, while that's loading, we will see what else we can find over here. IDVC looking to trump that high day at 0039, it looks like. 3.2 million volume now, plus 9.1%. All right, here we go. See what other kind of action we got going on today here. Looks like ECDC is getting a little action again today. The last trade for 11 was 50 cents. I know you mentioned that one, Seema, but wow. Must be some decent news there. 158,000 volume. Let's go check out that news. I'm bored. Elevate grows sales with successful launch. 42% growth in daily sales volume for the 2 weeks following the May 15th launch of its 2012 door program. Company also posted a record sales week, beating the previous week by 23%. I don't even know what these guys do. I think this one's on promotion too. That might be part of the reason why it's up so much. I think I got a couple of emailers on it, so definitely keep that in mind. But it's getting some good action today. Nice little fat 67,000 share bid sitting on 50 cents there. Ask 55. High of the day is 50 cents. Didn't even gap that much today. 100% intraday opportunity by the looks of it. I wonder how large. Ooh, nice little 50,000 share order to open up the day at 9:31. That's pretty significant. AGRT moving to some high of days here. 57.4 cents up 14.3%. Still some real good bid support forming once it broke that 50 mark. Trade high of the day, 58 cents. 1.5 million in volume now. I think we mentioned yesterday that there is a big promotion group on this one. Is that right, Seema? Or were there rumors of a big promotion group coming on this one?
Which one was that?
AGRT.
Yeah, there was a big promo on it. They started it up yesterday, and I got more emails overnight on it. A lot of big emailers on it. There were some big budgets on it.
Gotcha. I haven't checked my spam folder in a couple days, so I'm assuming I got a few in there. Alistair really likes this 0022 by 0027 spread. There is ask coming down there a little bit to 0026, almost 6 million in volume now, though. IDVC, bid support creeping up a little bit here. Had some ask hits on 004 there, so making some new high days. Trying to find support here at 0038, 265,000 share bids sitting there.
Yeah, AGRT looking pretty strong here so far today.
Yeah, it is. Man, level 2 is taking forever to load today. Papa getting a little bit of a promotion as well, I think. Current spread 7.5 by 7.9. Looks like it gapped a little bit from yesterday, and it might be moving down to fill that gap. So I'm not even going to spend any more time on it. They did put out press. It's on promotion. A little bit of action. Wow, it is a boring day in the markets. At least on my side of things. Let's see what's been hot.
Yeah, a little bit of a slow day. I don't know about you, Haas, but I'm ready to call it a day since nothing's really happening. Nothing's too exciting. We got a little bit of a dull, lackluster start to the day, other than a couple of these.
I am really trying to find a runner, and I'm just. I don't know. It's slow Wednesday. Everybody's prepping for the NHL playoffs tonight, obviously.
Got a few here we can look at here on the big boards. Got the experts only scanner running. Let's check these out real quick. First one up, we got Scott's Miracle-Gro. And we're going to look at weekly 3 years on every single one of these to give you the big picture. These aren't pennies. These are big boards. And you can see here on our Scott's Miracle-Gro, just like we said on Ford, look at this 200 MA support. And it almost looks like the Ford chart, actually. Support. Well, here she is again. She tried to find support. Let's see if she can hold it. Basically, the way I look at this is when you got a 200 MA right here and she can't hold this, going back to your old resistance right here in 2009, you can see she broke out. Well, if she can't hold, I'd say break down. So who knows? Maybe Scott's Miracle-Gro is a short if it cannot hold these levels. The next one we're going to look at here is AIG, and you can't even see what this thing's doing on a weekly 3 year. So it's like a different one. FCX. She has broken below that 200 MA, but what you've got going on here is you can see you've got support. If I could get something to work. There you go. You got one, two, going for number three. Let's see if she holds here. And you can see this thing has had one hell of a downtrend. Marked by that, and the latest of this trend is even steeper. And you can see if you throw one on here, and you can put it on here, or you can put it on here. There is a lot of downside in FCX if she can't hold these levels. So keep your eye on that. Here's one. Let's look. Or is this one? No. J&J, guys. Johnson and Johnson coming up on the 200 MA as well. You can see this thing has been trading in this channel for quite some time. If you take it off down, man, my clicker is not working at all. But you can see if you stacked it right on there, she's already broken down. I'm going to put it on this one right here and say that 200 MA is key. Keep your eye on J&J and that 200 moving average. This thing's got a nice yield, definitely a blue chip. Let's look at Alamo Group. It looks like it is clearly in breakout mode. You can see that illustrated by that. It came down and retested it. Keep your eye on that. If she can't hold, going back lower. Let's look at one of my favorites here, Verizon. Look at that, Haas. 41.58. And who knows where she's going, but one of my favorite stocks. I wouldn't want to be pulling the trigger right here, even with the yield as good as it is. I want a little bit of a discount. But keep it on radar. Radar, the old breakout, say around 40. Keep your eye on 40. Let's look at Hog. Harley Davidson, another one that looks like it could be a potential breakout. And it has broken the 20 MA. It's trying to get back above, but keep your eye on it. You can see all the moving averages move through that 200 MA. That was awesome. Got to keep your eye on those 200 MA breakouts. Matter of fact, we've got a scanner running on that now. And I'm going to start posting them in the room. So let's look at one more here, one that's just been getting hammered, and that is Caterpillar. And I want to take this thing even farther back. Let's look at a 10-year on this, and it looks like I already got a line on it. You can see the trend that it's done over the long term. You could pull it closer here, but we went off of this one, and you can see Caterpillar is at a very, very bad spot in this chart. It is below the 100 MA, okay? If it breaks this support line, you get your 200 MA all the way down at 72. I can't imagine Caterpillar going to 72. That'd be crazy. But what I want to look at here is you got these three tops here. One, two, three. And you can see that if you stacked it on the first one or the second one, you're below that. That was the old support. We need to get back above it. You can see illustrated by this candle here with the wick, it actually came up right to it, to these old, you know, we always talk about it. That was a breakout right there. And you can see that it just powered through it. And then it came back through. And where did it find its support after it fell down? Well, of course, it found it off of its old support. Now, you know, was resistance, now support. And you can see that illustrated there. But, yep, Caterpillar, guys, watch out. I know a couple people in it. Haas, remember when it was trading around 105 and I said I better put my stop in? Thank God I did. But keep it on the radar. Caterpillar, guys. C-A-T. Okay, now I'm done rambling. Let's wrap it up, boys.
All right, move it back to me quick. I actually found a couple of active ones before we head out for the day. Degree, Dutch Gold Resources. This one made the huge run. I think the 006s, 007s, we caught it, you know, around this 001 area the first time when they started putting out some more significant press. Get a little bit of action today, 11.8 million in volume so far, up 10% on the day. It did put out some press. It was pretty good press, so go check that out for sure. BFHJ, Beneficial Holdings, super, super sub-penny lotto trips. Just moved through the 0002s. It's gotten a small tap on 0003, it looks like, which is up 50%. But, you know, obviously really, really thick on the threes there yet. This one has a lot of trouble with that 0003s, 0004 area. So I'm definitely not a buyer, but it's getting a little action this morning. They did put out some press, so go do your due diligence, check out the press. THWI, I've been getting some action here. Looking pretty good again today. Almost a million in volume, 822,000 shares in volume. Last trade at 7.16 cents, which is plus 8.5% on the day. Finished at 6.6 yesterday, opened up today at 6.85, basically filled the gap there. AGRT still making new highs, touched 62 cents, current spread 60 by 60.9 cents, up 21.5%, 2.5 million volume now today. So still getting tons of action. Classic dip and rip early on this morning. That was fun to watch. All right, that's all I got. Unless you guys got something else, let's roll out. Sumo.
Good job today, guys. Yeah, I'm ready to roll out.
All right. Well, thanks for tuning in, folks.
We appreciate all the listeners tuning in. And be sure to check us out on the evening show, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Stock Traders Talk Radio, and we're out.
Aloha.
Thank you for listening to Stock Traders Talk Radio. All views and topics talked about on Stock Traders Talk Radio is solely for entertainment purposes. We are not professional financial advisors and always recommend you seek the advice of a professional financial advisor. Never invest in any stock featured on our show unless you can afford to lose your entire investment. The information contained on our show is based on sources which we believe to be reliable, but is not guaranteed by us as being accurate, and might not be a complete statement or summary of the available data. Stock Traders Talk Radio advises that the investments in companies profiled are commonly considered to be high risk, and use of the information provided is at the investor's sole risk. Thank you for listening to Stock Traders Talk Radio.